Hey, welcome back to the Barrel Proof Baseball Podcast. Today's episode was one I was able to film a while back. Haven't been able to release it due to my real work. And so finally getting this sent out. I'm really excited. This is one of my favorite conversations that I've had, I think. I don't know that I've been introduced to a brand that is readily available that I've enjoyed as much as this one. So today I'm talking with Brian Treacy. Brian is the president of Sagamore Spirit out of Baltimore, Maryland. I'd never had Sagamore Spirit. I'd seen it on the shelf, never tried it out. I got a bottle of their rye sent to me and I thought it was delicious. For my call, I had that. And then I went and picked up the double oak from Sagamore Spirit. And it was just amazing. Possibly one of my new favorite bottle. After our talk, we actually had another group call with Brian, with our group, and he sent out some samples. We tried the cask strength. We tried the tequila finish. I mean, these are just incredible bottles. I don't think you'll go wrong. I would definitely recommend it. I picked up the Manhattan finish, based on Brian's recommendation. And this is just amazing as well. The cask strength. I mean, these are just, they're incredible bottles. A little disappointed that I had not tried these sooner. So do yourself a favor, pick up some Sagamore Spirit. You're definitely not going to regret it. It is money well spent. It's very good whiskey. Once you watch this or listen to it or whatever means you are hearing or seeing this by, I think you're going to agree that you're going to be very supportive of Sagamore Spirits and Brian Treacy. Such a super cool, like down-to-earth guy. Really enjoyed my conversation with him, really enjoyed our follow-up call with him, with our group. It was just awesome. So check these out. I think you're going to enjoy it. Go pick up some Sagamore Spirit and leave me some messages. Let me know what you think about it. Support the Barrel Proof Baseball Podcast. Check out the links below, whether you are listening on Apple, Spotify, Google, Podbean. If you're watching this on YouTube, check out the Patreon. Check out the Amazon store, check out, what else? I don't remember. Just click on links, put your card in and send money. Yeah, that's it. Shameful plug. I'm not afraid to do it, but, that's it. Check this out. Let me know what you think. Check out Sagamore Spirit. Go grab a bottle. You're going to like it. I promise. All right. Cheers. All right. Joined here today with Brian Treacy from Sagamore Spirit. Brian, thanks so much for joining me today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much for having us.
All right. So first and foremost, I'm going to tell you that I'm somewhat new to rye. My first experience with rye was not overly positive. I didn't love it. And then I had some more and I started to like them. So I was excited to try this one out and get one that I really like. And I'm looking forward to kind of learn a little bit more about these. So,
yeah, you know, we're looking forward to sharing more with you. And, you know, that's definitely not the first time I've heard that. But I think, you know, I look forward to sharing a little bit about what makes Sagamore different and what really kind of what Maryland style rye is. And because we do view it as potentially a little bit more approachable, but love to get into some of that and what we do to kind of make our whiskeys taste different. And a lot of people can be surprised compared to other ryes about how approachable it can be.
Yeah, I agree. I was pumped last night when I tried this. I was like, all right, this could go for a lot of different people's palates, I believe. But can we start a little bit? Let's talk about yourself and kind of where were you before? I know you mentioned Flagstaff before we started, but what were you doing before you got in with Sagamore Spirit? And kind of give me a little bit about how you got into it as well.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. It's a question when people, you know, think that what distillery were you working at before? Where did you come from? And then when I tell them that I was living in Flagstaff, Arizona, and I owned a backpacking and kayaking tour company in the Grand Canyon and in Southern Utah and Yosemite, they kind of scratched their head. How did that happen? And had a little outdoor store up there and a ski rental shop. And really what it came from is I knew what are the co-founders from back in the day, way back in the day. And at the end of the day, they kind of looked at me and they had this idea about starting a whiskey distillery for a long time because Maryland had this great history of distilling, yet no one in Maryland was really doing it. This Maryland, this idea of Maryland style rye lived on for decades without anybody, a few people doing it. I mean, which was great, but no one in Maryland really doing it. And so they approached me, I think, really kind of from the entrepreneurial side, saying like, here's the vision. Here's what we'd like to do. Can you get this business off the ground? And so I love that challenge. I love the taking something from concept to life. It's super exciting to see that happen. And of course, the people you meet along the way. And the first thing I did is hire some really smart people who kind of knew what they were doing, did distilling. And from there, you know, it for me, it's not too different than what I was doing before as far as starting a business. There's just certain basics that go with any business that you're starting. There's a lot more compliance with this one. And then for me too, you know, hiking and backpacking in the Grand Canyon is providing a great hospitality and a great memory. And we provide, I think, a great hospitality experience when you visit our distillery. We have some of the best hospitality in the industry. And then hopefully you find a really great experience in the glass.
Were you a whiskey fan before this? Was that your go-to drink, or were you into something else?
I kind of rotated between three things. I like, and I still experiment a little bit, but you know, I like to always see what's happening out there. But I was whiskey, tequila, and beer. Mm-hmm. Was kind of my three things, if you will. But for me, whiskey was kind of Jim Beam, and then when somebody introduced me to Makers at one point, I was like, wow, this is really fancy. And that opened up my eyes and was like, realized that was just like the tip of the iceberg on how many great whiskeys are really out there. And the curiosity grew as I got into this business.
So what was like that moment for you? It always makes me kind of interested to hear when people have, you know, something that they're into, something that they're doing, and then they change ventures in their life or change their career path and go, okay, like my buddies have this idea and you decide like, I'm going to jump in, let's do this. Like, what is that moment like? And like, what led you to say, like, this sounds like something that could be, you know, a very good idea. Let's leave, you know, Flagstaff and what I'm doing and let's jump in.
You know, I was very lucky. Living in Flagstaff is a great, great city, a great town. If you ever haven't visited, get out there and check it out. I mean, basically my office view was the Grand Canyon. So, I mean, it wasn't a bad thing at all. But, you know, I had kind of been doing that for almost 15 years and it was doing well. But when this opportunity came along, I just couldn't say no. I didn't realize, even though I grew up in Maryland, that we had such a history of distilling in Maryland, and then what an idea, the idea to bring that history, that legacy back to life and put Maryland back on the map was such an opportunity. And, you know, you go into it, yeah, you're a little bit nervous. It's a new venture. You're picking up the wife and the kids and moving across country and settling back in, and but you know, my family was still in Maryland, and my wife's family's from upstate New York, so for us, closer back to family, and just seemed like a once in a lifetime opportunity that I just couldn't say no to.
Can you talk a little bit about that history of like rye whiskey in Maryland? Because I think people instinctually go to like Pennsylvania rye, but it sounds like from what I've kind of looked into a little bit, there's a fairly deep history with Maryland rye.
Yeah, no, and understandable for people to do that. You know, history and distilling goes back 158 years before Kentucky was really even a state. And, you know, in the 1500s, 1600s in Maryland, we're distilling mostly rum at the time. But like a lot of things come along, some taxes and tariffs got hit on the sugars and molasses. And so they didn't want to pay those taxes and tariffs on the sugars and molasses. And so we had a tremendous amount of immigration into the Baltimore area. We're right on the Inner Harbor, so it's the second largest site for immigration next to Ellis Island. So we had a lot of people come from Ireland, Scotland, Germany, Poland, who knew about rye grain and knew how to distill grain-based type products. And so instead of paying those taxes and tariffs, in the early 1700s, they just started switching over to rye whiskey. And, you know, it flourished from there. We have some tensions with the British, a little something called the Revolutionary War. We come out of that, we're $54 million in debt, and they decide they're going to start taxing all the whiskey distilleries on a high level. And of course, the rumblings of that happen. And that's when you start hearing about the Whiskey Rebellion coming out of the 1780s into the 1790s. And that's when families like Marion Jacob Beam and Basil Hayden actually picked up and left Maryland and moved to places that weren't developed yet that would eventually be called Kentucky. But luckily, you know, Whiskey Rebellion ends, taxes get reduced. Distilling flourishes in this country. We get to 1910, Maryland has 44 distilleries, all licensed. 21 in downtown Baltimore, all make and rye whiskey. We keep making it through Prohibition. It's one of the reasons Maryland's called the Free State. And then into the early 30s, they start paying farmers to stop growing rye, subsidizing corn, getting ready for World War II and ethanol needs. And over half of the distilleries in this country switched to ethanol production to support World War II. And eventually, distilling really never made much of a comeback in Maryland. And the last distillery closed its doors in 1982, sold that name off to Heaven Hill, and that's Pikesville Rye. And so again, we saw, you know, here's Kentucky distilleries that even wanted to buy up the Maryland brand names, and Maryland rye whiskey was considered really superior whiskey, so much that, you know, the identity and the brand lived on without actually anybody in Maryland doing it. But, you know, the original American whiskey is rye whiskey, and the birthplace is in the Mid-Atlantic between Virginia, Maryland, and Pennsylvania.
I think it's cool, the, you know, you have all the folklore of whiskey in Kentucky and everything like that, especially, but, you know, like you mentioned Basil Hayden's, and I'm not a Basil Hayden's fan myself, but I know it's a high rye whiskey kind of in homage to Basil Hayden because of the, you know, the area that he came from. So I think those stories, how they kind of get interconnected, is really cool. It's kind of a fun part of whiskey that I think is the stories are a lot of fun to pay attention to.
Yeah. We often call rye bourbon's older brother.
That's great. All right. So you make the decision to jump in, like you got the history behind it, everything's rolling. What's the process like? Like, how do you get this thing going? I'm sure there's a ton of, you know, red tape you've got to take care of and permitting and all that stuff. But what is that like getting this company started?
Yeah, there is a it is probably the most regulated industry in the country. And understandably, I mean, obviously alcohol needs to be monitored very closely. So that was a new undertaking for me, the amount of complexity when it came to compliance and legal. There's three things that you basically I charged at, and that was, one, product development. What is it going to be? What's it going to be like? And then go to market strategy. And then you have brand. And so those are the three most important things as far as getting the business off the ground. And then you also have this other undertaking, which was a huge undertaking, was building a 66,000 square foot distillery. You really start that process by saying, what do you want to make and how much do you want to make? And that kind of determines the equipment you need, how much you need, and kind of the size of your distillery. So we have a beautiful distillery in downtown Baltimore located right on the waterfront. We have a restaurant there called Rye Street Tavern. We have one building's a visitor center with tasting rooms, a cocktail bar. You know, we run tours. You can go into operations and learn about all the distilling and bottling. We have processing and bottling, and then distillation, where we have 6,000 gallon cooker, 9,6500 gallon fermenters, an 8,000 gallon beer well, a 40-foot column still that runs off of two 350 gallon doublers for triple distillation. We also have a 250 gallon pot still batch system for pilot systems and R&D. So you're not only getting a business out the door, but you're actually building the facility for production, which was something very new to me. I'm not an engineer by any means. And so I was very lucky to team up with a guy by the name of Larry Ebersole, who was the master distiller and worked at Seagram's and MGP for over 40 years. And I call him the godfather of rye whiskey. He's distilled more rye whiskey than anybody in the world. And he came in and he was a real mentor to me. And it was just wonderful to work with alongside of such a talented human being and learn as much as you can. I mean, we have over 2 miles of process piping alone. Oh. And then, you know, you deal with the fact that you're dealing with a very combustible product too. You know, those vapors are very, very dangerous, you know. And so everything's explosion proof and EE rated. So it was a wild undertaking. But we got the distillery, it's up and running and it's beautiful and got into market and so forth.
Now, when did you guys actually start? I think it was online, April of 17. Was that when you guys actually got going?
Correct. We got the distillery open to the public in April of 17.
Okay.
So the backstory is, luckily with Larry's connection, we started contract distilling, which isn't, you know, too different than what a lot of folks will do. It's kind of basically almost like renting time on someone's still. And we did that with MGP, where Larry had connections. And we said, why don't we start laying down whiskey now to a recipe that we want while we're building out our distillery. And then in 2016, we actually launched our product into the market. And in 2017, we opened up our distillery to the public. And in the meantime, you know, we've transitioned out of MGP into 100% here in Maryland and in Baltimore for production. And so, but we knew it was a bad business plan. Say, let's spend 4 years building and designing a distillery and then 4 or 5 years aging your product and 9 years later collect dollar one. No one could do that.
Yeah, I can't understand how people could potentially, like you said, let's build this, let's wait 4 years and then we'll start making money. Like that, you're in a good position in life already if you can you can hold off that long.
Yeah.
So going to MGP, this always interests me, but do you take, because this is two mash bills, is that correct?
Yeah.
So do you go to MGP and say, like, these are the mash bills that we're really looking at? Is that something that they have that you guys kind of say, okay, we want these blended, or do you go in saying specifically, this is what we're looking for? Like, how does that kind of process work in terms of actually picking out like the spirit that you're going to have in your bottles?
Yeah. So we do, you're exactly right. We distill two different mash bills and we were doing a lot of R&D, and you know, MGP, when it comes to rye, is kind of famous for their 95% rye, 5% mm-hmm. malted barley recipe that you see in a lot of the products. We like that. We like that mash bill. But Maryland was always known as a little bit sweeter, a little bit more floral, a little bit more approachable rye. So we wanted also something that would be a barely legal rye. So just like it is to be straight bourbon in their mm-hmm. mash bill, you have to be at least 51% corn in your mash bill to be a straight bourbon, and a few other regulations. We have to be at least 51% rye to be a straight rye. So we do one that's also called a barely legal rye that we ask them to make. So 52% rye, 43% corn, 5% malted barley, and we'll age that separately. So both of those products get aged separately for about 4 to 7 years, and then we blend those two together in every product we have. So you kind of get that spicy complexity that you might expect from the high rye mm-hmm. with this really nice balance and like fruity floralness from that low rye. So we approach them, and I don't think if we didn't have Larry, I'm not so sure they would have taken the call. So it was very just kind of one of those perks of having him in your corner, because he had the connections and they were kind enough to oblige by that. So we ran with two different mash bills. And so it wasn't that complicated, but I think we also got lucky.
So how, now are you guys, now you said you're making your own stuff now. Are you still using the MGP distillate that you guys had been selling before you switched? Like, have you switched over to like out in market using your own stuff, or is that still to come?
That is to come in the coming months.
I was going to say, it's got to be getting up there.
This is like, yeah, our whiskey's, our whiskey's now over 4 years old. And like straight rye is a blend of 4 to 6 year. And the double oak is 6.5, and our cask strength's a blend of 4 to 7. So we're going to start putting in Maryland made product into the bottle this year. And then it's a little hard to know, but we think it'll be maybe 18 months or so as we blend through before it becomes 100% Maryland made.
Gotcha. Now is there a kind of that crossover in terms of them making the stuff at MGP with, you know, whatever grains they're using in terms of like geographically, is that something that you guys try to mimic or get the same grains that they're using so that you keep the consistency between what MGP was making to what you guys are putting out? Or is it, you know, potentially going to be kind of a different or even subtle differences in like flavor profiles because the grains are different?
That's such a great question. We started off using the same yeast strands that they use. We worked with the same grain suppliers that they use. So really wanted to mimic, because we really love the product that we have, really mimic what they were doing and try and transition to that. Now, the flora and fauna of aging in Maryland is a little different than Indiana. Their tanks are really old and have some, you know, historic bacteria and things like that that we're never going to have in our system. So there will be subtle differences. Hopefully people think to the better, if you will. Yeah. And then, you know, we'll also eventually transition to some other products, because we have started growing some working with local farmers as well. So not only do we still work with Brooks and Consolidated Grain, like we did with MGP, but we're now also doing kind of a shared value program with some of the local farmers here, where you actually come to find out rye grain is one of the only uninsurable crops there is. And so getting folks in Maryland to grow rye for you, there was a lot of risk to that. So we said, why don't we buy the seed so you have no out-of-pocket expense? We won't hold you to a yield per acre. We'll just hold you to a quality standard. We'll buy silos so you don't have to invest in that. We'll just work together in a true partnership. And, you know, we've recently transitioned Sagamore Farm, which is where we get the spring water to proof our whiskeys, to our farm, which used to be kind of famous for thoroughbred horse racing. But we've transitioned that to growing rye and 100% of our non-GMO corn. And then two other farms here in Maryland we work with. And the first year we grew 50,000 pounds. Second year, about 150,000 pounds. Then we got to about 500,000 pounds. And last year we did over 700,000 pounds. And this year we think we'll do over 1 million pounds of Maryland-grown rye grain. And then we're working with the University of Maryland Department of Ag on five different strands to really understand the different flavor notes and components you can get out of different strands. And so that's some products that can come down the road. In the meantime, we want to stay as consistent as possible, but some interesting things in the pipeline for sure. And we're super excited about that. But, you know, we still mill over 3 million pounds of rye a year.
Wow. It's incredible. I mean, when you start thinking about just that, like 3 million pounds is so much rye. Like, it's absurd. And I think it's interesting too, like when you start to look at like the big brands in Kentucky, you know, and I've talked to a number of craft distilleries and they say like Jim Beam spills more in a day than we put out in a year. You know, like it's just the total output of what's actually getting out there is just incredible. When you start thinking about just sheer numbers and quantity, I think it really is amazing. So I can understand like going from an MGP to making your own, there's gotta be that moment, like kind of that oh shit moment, you know, like this is our stuff now. Like this is on us.
Yeah. This is a defining moment for us this year. We have to nail it as we begin to put our product into the bottle. We're fairly confident, but we're not going to be arrogant about it. Like, but we're taking this incredibly serious. This is it. You get to do this once, if you will, you know, and this is a big moment for us. And we're going to ask people, you know, we'll always be very transparent. And you got to have thick skin and candor in this business too. You know, people tell you like it is, and that's cool. That's totally cool. We get that. So, but we're super excited. We're very proud of what we've built. We've had some very positive feedback from some very smart and experienced industry palates.
Yeah, that's got to be awesome. I mean, especially when you hear from some of those people that are enjoying the spirits that you're making. And not just what you're, I mean, again, it is a big deal because you're responsible for blending the spirits that are going into your bottles, but now it's your own stuff. I mean, to hear people that are into it, that's got to be pretty, pretty rewarding, I would imagine.
It's exciting. It definitely, it puts a big smile on your face because I've been at it now for 8 years and you know, that's kind of how long it can take. If you think about that journey and that's a blink of an eye in the world of whiskey.
I bet.
So what is your
role kind of on a day-to-day or just big picture, you know, big picture type of a theme? Like what is your role in the company?
So, by title, they say it's president. You know, it's like, again, we're small. I was there today rolling up hoses underneath the fermenters. It's like, you know, we'll play any role necessary, but overall I really have to provide the direction and the strategy and make sure it's fairly clearly stated on what we're trying to accomplish and then provide the resources necessary for the team to accomplish that. So you have a finger in everything. You're working very closely with hospitality, operations, finance, and especially sales and marketing.
So what is I don't think I've ever asked anybody this, but what is like the main, and this might sound stupid, but like what is the main, you know, objective? Is it making good whiskey to get it out to as many people as possible? Is it creating a good, you know, visitors experience when they come to Maryland? Or just overall, like, is that the theme of just creating a brand that identifies as, you know, good whiskey, good experience when you go visit? You know, what is it that you guys are going for?
So I'll answer that with our mission statement is to inspire a global passion for Maryland rye whiskey. So right now, if you ask somebody what's Maryland rye whiskey, a lot of people just say, I guess whiskey made in Maryland. But, you know, to really kind of like, kind of what, you know, we had it, and Pennsylvania has it with Monongahela, and Kentucky has it, and Tennessee has it, and California has it for wine. Like, it's our job to kind of get that back. And then, you know, our vision is really to establish Sagamore Spirit as a premier distiller. And we always say through our people, and that could be our team, that could be our community here in Baltimore, and through our craft, and whether that's our actual whiskey or that's an experience you get in our hospitality center. And then, of course, our people, our craft is really the most important thing that we have. Like, and of course, our distillery. And so anything that you may come and experience. So that's kind of how we approach it every day. That's what drives us. That's kind of our northern light, if you will.
I love it. I think any, like you mentioned, rolling up hoses, the president of the, you know, the brand of the company is rolling up hoses. And it's the whole idea of, you know, if you're too big for a small job, you're too small for a big job. Like, go out and, you know, like, do what has to be done. I mean, it's, everybody has to kind of chip in, get their stuff done. And it's the only thing that really matters. And, you know, the people that are there, whether it's consumers or people that are working there, I think that's what makes any company or brand successful. So I think that's really cool.
The people are the most important, and everybody matters, and everybody brings value.
For sure. And it's the collective, I forgot the word, but they just, the collective strength of everybody becomes better than, you know, the strength of the individuals.
Yeah. Greater than the sum.
Yes. Okay. So you've mentioned a couple times the water. What is unique or different about the water that's coming out of your area?
Yeah. So we have out on, our farm was founded in 1925, but if you ever look at our bottle, you'll notice the embossing says 1909. And come to find out, the entire farm was built on a shelf of limestone aquifers. And out in the middle of this field on our farm is this little spring house. And on the outside is chiseled 1909 CAC. And that's Charles A. Councilman, who got a grant from the University of Maryland to study limestone aquifers and their effects on agriculture and livestock. And when you open up the door to this building, there's no floor. There's just limestone spring water coming up out of the earth.
Wow.
And we studied that spring for over 3 years, and it's some of the highest grade quality water in the Mid-Atlantic region. And so, you know, after you age your whiskey 4, 5, 6 years, you really want to proof it with the best water you can get your hands on. And that limestone filtered spring water is really key, because it's so rich in calcium and so many interesting minerals that bring that kind of local terroir to it. And then, of course, it's iron free because it just gets naturally filtered out. And if you have iron in your water, your whiskey turns a lot of funky colors.
Interesting. So I don't know if that's something that I think people would necessarily look at, like how important that is. You know, if you're running tap water out of Arizona in there, it's probably not going to come out very good, but I assume that good water definitely helps improve the quality of the whiskey.
Absolutely. I mean, after all, right. What's whiskey mean in Gaelic, right? Water. And yeah. So just like
water of life.
Yeah, water of life, right? It's just water of life. And it's just one of these things, like, that is the base ingredient, really, at the end of the day, is the water. And, you know, it's something that, you know, Kentucky, Maryland, just everybody can pretty much agree upon.
So I'm curious what you, before we talk a little bit more about these, like, individually, you had mentioned earlier about kind of people being hesitant getting into rye. Like, what do you think it is? And I will tell you, like, my very first experience with rye, I wasn't into it. I didn't care for like the spice, but I do tend to enjoy high rye bourbons. I love Irish whiskey, and I don't know that the crossover between the rye and like an Irish whiskey is necessarily there. But I've begun to like more ryes. And I think I tried something that was a very high rye content out of Pennsylvania. Didn't care for it. Went down to like a Rittenhouse, which is just over that threshold of the 51%. And kind of ease my way up. And now I find myself liking more ryes that have a higher content. But like you're mentioning how you have the high rye mash bill combined with the one that's barely legal to create that Maryland style sweetness. I think it adds a really nice balance, but just out of curiosity, what do you think it is that makes people not really care for the ryes?
Yeah, it's such a great question. And, you know, I guess most of it's kind of just a little bit of guess for us, but I think there's a few things. One, I think there's a lot of people that are still just newer to whiskey in general. And if you jump over here, this is technically a spicier grain. And it can catch people off guard. I also think even though rye was the original American whiskey and it was made for so long, it almost went completely extinct at one point, right? And if it wasn't for the fact that they used it as a little bit of a blender component in like Crown Royal, and there was a few like Old Overhaul and Pikesville and, you know, Rittenhouse, like you mentioned, it was borderline extinct. So then there's a bunch of people who start making it again. And depending on when you tried it, I always question whether it was a really young one. You know, was it young? It just didn't have the right time yet in the barrel. Or did they use smaller barrels? And sometimes that can provide a lot of tannins to it as well. It's I can only speculate, but I always ask people, you know, it's not uncommon for me here. Like, I've tried rye, I think I'm good. And they'll say, let me guess, it's pretty angular. It burned. It ripped out the back of your throat. It just was like, I almost want to say when it's so bold, it's like borderline one dimensional, you know, and we're looking to create something that's balanced and it's got complexity and it's got layers. And I think we find it, we see that with using the two different mash bills, which we like. And it also creates something that is very, what we consider to be approachable, because it's just not really angular.
Yeah. I think when I try something that's very rye, and maybe you're, that's what it is the, like the youthfulness of a rye or something, some other factor. I feel like some of them, it almost gives you like a, for lack of a better word, like a effervescent, like spearminty, like feel, you know, in your mouth, not the taste of like a mint, but just that feel of like a coolness kind of coming through, which I don't really expect. And so I think when you have it, if you're not expecting it after that spice, it's like, ooh, I don't know if I love that.
You know, absolutely. It's a word that I hear occasionally, and I think it's accurate, but it always tends to bother me. But you almost get like this menthol from some. Yeah. And yeah. Like, you know, like menthol is not something people necessarily seek out.
No. Unless it's a Marlboro and you're in college.
Exactly, right? It's like, trying to only associate that with one thing, man.
Yeah, it's not good either.
Yeah, not something I'm looking for.
All right, but, go ahead.
No, I just said, but hopefully we can help change that, you know?
Definitely. Okay, so let's talk about this one. So this is your kind of your standard, right?
Yeah.
So 83 proof. First, talk a little bit about the bottle. Like, I think the shape of the bottle is cool and it sticks out. And I think that is a part of kind of the buying experience. If you see it on a shelf, like, it's at least going to catch somebody's eye. I think that's cool. I really like the bottle. Is there anything behind it, like in terms of a reason behind like the shape of it, design?
Yeah, absolutely. And we absolutely, you know, it's a very unique bottle and we know that. And it kind of goes back to, just to give you a backstory, kind of with being a guy not from the industry, which was kind of comical, is when we designed this bottle, we were super proud of it. And we're like, this thing's beautiful, just gorgeous. And then you start taking it to glass manufacturers and labelers, and they're like, and you show them pictures, and they're like, wow, that's beautiful. And then they kind of give you this like stink eye, like, you're not from the industry, are you? like, I'm not. They're like, you're never going to get a label on that thing. And it's just like, well, we get a label on it every day. And it requires a little effort, but it's worth it. So what really kind of inspired us behind this bottle was, like, again, the legacies here in Maryland with some of the distillers. There was such beautiful glass. Back in the day, if you looked at bottles back in the day, they weren't as boring as ours. They're like really cool. They were like always unique. They had interesting embossing on them. And there's one that really jumped out at us. There's a kind of a really nice, beautiful museum here in Baltimore called the Walters Museum. Lots of beautiful art. Well, come to find out, Walters made all of his money selling rye whiskey in the 1800s. And he had a beautiful six-sided bottle with embossing down the side, like hand-blown. We just thought that bottle was absolutely gorgeous. And then our farm, which was originally started by the Vanderbilt family in 1925, the jockey silks were these three diamonds that you see on the bottle. And so it was kind of a nod to the folks in the past and those beautiful bottles they used to make. And then kind of, you know, old meets new. And then it's also a little bit diamond shaped like our logo. And of course, you know, there's no front or back to it until we actually put a label on it. So from a production standard, it makes life pretty easy. You don't have to worry about a front or back until we hit it with a label. So that's kind of the backstory on that.
Yeah. I mean, it's beautiful. It's kind of heavyweight. I mean, it's really a nice ball. I think there's some cool bottles that are out there and there's some other ones that are not so cool. And I think it definitely adds to it. And I don't care what anybody says. Like, there's definitely shelf appeal to seeing something like this on the bottle. You at least get curious to take a look at it.
Yes, for sure.
So 4 to 7 years, is that what you said on this one?
This one's 4 to 6. Our cat 4 to 6. 4 to 7, but this is 4 to 6 years old.
Okay. And then what does this, so like the cask strength, for example, what does that come out at? In terms of, like, not to switch bottles here, but the cask strength, what does that come out at? Like, in terms of how much does this need to be proofed down to get to that 83 proof?
Yeah, good question. So we do a barrel entry proof at 120. And then what we see currently from the barrels coming out of the old Seagram's warehouses, which are big, thick stone warehouses, is we're seeing that we're typically coming out when we exit the barrel between 112 and 115. We've seen the occasional 117, but we actually going down in proof. Mm-hmm. And then obviously we proof this down to 83 with a spring water. We've seen now here in Maryland with, instead of being big stone buildings, we have thin kind of metal sided warehouses, and our proof is actually going up. We're coming out of the barrel more like 124, things along those lines. So that's really kind of some interesting things we've learned as far as, you know, rick houses, the different styles and the way it affects your whiskey.
Do you see, not to skip, but like the difference in terms of climate with like Indiana where MGP's at and their aging stuff versus, you know, in Maryland, I mean, kind of similar climates, aren't they? You're going to get hot and humid and you're going to get cold and icy and snow.
Yeah. So that's exactly our takeaway too. You know, Kentucky, Indiana, Maryland really have very similar weather. You know, we'll have a decent winter. We'll get snow. We'll be freezing. You know, we'll get hot in the summer. You know, I mean, 96 plus humidity, whatever. We'll break 100 occasionally. So it is, and then we definitely have that humidity, and we're on water, so we definitely got the humidity. But that's what we kind of decided was like, old big thick stone buildings can only get so hot. Mm. And then what we're seeing is the rick houses we've built here, the metal siding, and we paint the buildings black, and we don't condition them. We're averaging right now in the summer around 125, 127 Fahrenheit on the top rack.
Wow. So those things are, I mean, that's, it's getting into that wood.
Yeah. I mean, like the red line on that thing's going to be like right up to the edge. And then, you know, and then it'll bring it back through. So, I mean, it's going as deep in that wood as humanly possible. And obviously alcohol and water evaporate at different temperatures. Mm-hmm. And so we're seeing the water evaporate at a faster rate than the alcohol, unlike in the Seagram's warehouse.
So does that give you a fairly decent yield, especially at this 83%, or I'm sorry, 83 proof once you've proofed it down?
Yeah. No, we're definitely, I mean, if you have the same angel share, let's say, but the barrel exit proof is 114 on one and the other one's 124, we just fell into more whiskey.
Yeah, that's awesome. Talk about some tasting notes. I get one on the finish on this that I absolutely cannot shake, and I'm curious to see if anywhere close to what you get.
Yeah, you know, for me, like, the palate's always a little bit different for everybody. And, you know, people don't realize it's like, did you have a garlicky Caesar salad for lunch and you just forgot? When's the last time you had a cup of coffee? There's all these things can play a role. And so even if you love the whiskey or you didn't love the whiskey, it's always worth coming back, especially after some air gets in the bottle for a little bit, or leave it out on the counter, let it oxygenate for a little bit. But for me, on this, you know, a lot of the old Maryland rye whiskeys, they're 80 or 86 proof. So we split it down the middle with 83 proof, which again, you don't see many 83 proof whiskeys, so it's a little bit unique. And then on the nose, I just get a lot of those classic baking spices. I get a clove. Mm-hmm. I get a little bit of a nutmeg. But I also get this like orange citrusy peel and a little bit of vanilla. And then on the palate, and I always like to take a sip, acclimate, let it get all around my tongue, take another sip. And again, it's baking spices out of the gate. I got mint, I got cinnamon. But I feel the roll over to, I pick up a hint of dill. I pick up some like dried apricot. I get some caramel. I mean, that's kind of what I'm experiencing. But again, I don't want to say there's a right or wrong. If someone said something, I'd be like, you can't argue against that.
I think people feel like it's flavored and you have to get, you know, X, Y, Z. It's like, no, it's different for everyone. I get smoked at the very end with like dark chocolate or cocoa, and it just sits there, and I love it. And I had it last night and I was like, that's chocolate. Like, that is outstanding. So I was digging that a lot.
That's cool. I get that a lot, which is interesting that you say that. So cask strength is just the cask strength of the signature you're trying right now. And for me, cask strength is this like black pepper, white pepper, dark chocolate mocha. And so it's like, it's in there without a doubt.
Yeah.
Without a doubt. And that's really cool that you picked up on that.
Yeah, that was a big one for me. Like, I don't know why. Like, that, I think I've only had like one other one before where I was like, is that dark chocolate? Because you know, I try to, you know, read up and go, okay, what are people getting out of this? And I hear, you know, dark chocolate or cocoa, and I'm like, God, I just don't get it. And so last night was like one of the first ones I've ever said, like, that's definitely like a cocoa right there.
Yeah, for somebody, a cocoa might end up being a toasted oak, or a peppercorn, or like, you know, I wouldn't, a toffee, or I mean, it's all over the place. You know, someone will say, you know, like I said, a toasted oak, and another person will say graham cracker. Mm-hmm. You know, it's one of those things, like, you know, it's not uncommon for wood to put off kind of those classic, you know, walnut, pecan flavors. So if there's a lot of wood in there, people experience that. But if, you know, if you get into toasted oak, it can be very different than like just a charred oak. And then, you know, and there, I want people to know there's no wrong way to enjoy it. There's no wrong tasting note. It's your whiskey, and people have to associate it with something they experience once. So some people will just start. I've had people talk Mike and Ike's, and I've had people talk Twizzlers and Twixes, and that's just what they knew or whatever. Right. I was with a guy in Texas once. He's like, I grew up in a very rural area. Like, we just didn't have a lot of like a complexity of food or nothing. He's like, I can tell you all about trees. He's like, but my palate's like, he's like, this reminds me of three things. That's it. That's all I knew growing up. And it's just like, it is. Yeah. It's just like, what kind of food? If you just kind of eat the same thing regularly and there's nothing wrong with that, it's just kind of, you just can only associate so many flavors with it. It takes a long time.
Is this, and this might be a bad, not fair question, but in terms of using the two mash bills, like if you were to take what is in the bottle and, excuse me, and like actually look at like what the final mash bill would be, like what kind of rye content would you think, or do you know, is in the bottle itself?
We're up in the upper, we're probably actually in the upper, we're kind of the upper 70s, low 80s.
Okay. Wow. So it finishes up there pretty good. So the sweetness kind of offsets that 95.5, but still is going to be fairly up there.
Yeah. And I think people expect to hear a lower number, but we still obtain what we're trying to achieve, but it has a higher rye content. And the reason for that is we kind of go down in proof. And so we don't completely lose that rye complexity. We kind of turn up the rye level a little bit, if you will. Otherwise, it can fade off pretty easy. So, you know, and our double oak, we put more of the low mash bill in, right? So here's where we take down the high mash bill a little bit, play more with that low. And then the cask strength, we keep similar to signature because we want people to be able to kind of compare and see the difference basically of just what spring water does. And people typically want a cask strength rye, want big and bold.
Yeah, I can imagine. All right, let's go to this double oak. Now, I told you, I don't remember if we were filming yet, but I tried the rye last night and I was like, okay, this is good stuff. So I had to go pick up another bottle today. And I wasn't sure what I was going to get. And so I saw the double oak, and I think I like the double oak in terms of bourbons. Really enjoyed them, started to like a lot more of them. So I was really curious about how the rye double oak would be. So this is the one I had to go with in terms of trying a second bottle. So I want to get into this a little bit. So tell me a little bit more about the double oak.
Yeah. Can you tell me what batch you have on there too? That will help me out a little bit.
This is it, I can't, is that 50?
Oh, okay. Probably 5A.
But no, I can't tell if it's 5. It looks like 5B or 50.
Or 5B. I have 5D. I bet you got 5D.
5D, yeah.
We both got 5D. Okay.
Okay, perfect.
That's awesome.
I couldn't tell if it was 50 or 5D. I'm like, yeah, okay.
Yeah, some of our penmanship isn't as good as others, you know?
Right. We'll find a negative somewhere.
You know? Okay, so this one I think is interesting. And you mentioned it, Tony. I will tell you, when I was getting into this and what, you know, we didn't have our whiskey, I was drinking as many different whiskeys as I could. There was a certain double oak bourbon out there that is made in Kentucky that I'm a big fan of. Maybe it's made by Brown Forman Company. I can't remember.
Woodford. I'll say that without naming names.
Yeah. And I was a fan of it. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
And as I said, and I didn't see many double oak ryes on the market. And I just thought, I'd love to do that. And so what we end up doing with this is we'll age our two mash bills separately for 5 years. And after just over 5 years or so, we'll go ahead and blend them together. And we'll put them back into another new American oak barrel. What's interesting about this oak barrel is we cut grooves down the inside of the staves. So the lengths of the staves all the way down, we cut grooves. Gives you about 23 to 25% more surface area for the whiskey and to make contact with the wood. And so we call it a kind of groovy whiskey or a wave stave barrel, you know. And then instead of doing a heavy char and burning off those grooves, we just toast it. And then we do 18 more months inside that barrel. And so this is 6.5-year-old product. We think rye really peaks nicely around 6, 7, between 5 and 7. I think the color on this is absolutely.
I was thinking the same thing. This is super dark.
It's incredible, isn't it?
It's like a red amber. That's awesome.
And the legs and the oils I see on this, and so the mouthfeel on this is really interesting. Now we go up to 96.6 proof on this, so definitely more baking spice up on front. Almost like a toasted macaroon. I get some beautiful caramels out of this, though. It reminds me, something I love to do is like a toasted graham cracker and like
s'mores.
S'mores. So we do s'mores in our backyard. So when we do s'mores, we got a fire pit, the kids are out. It's like, this is my favorite whiskey. Well, it's one of my favorite whiskeys just about any time. But like when I'm doing a s'mores, I'm like, get me the double oak. Because pairing this with graham cracker, chocolate, and marshmallow is sensational.
Gotta be. I mean, for both of these, the finish on these, there's the flavor change to the finishes is phenomenal on both of them. Cause there's they linger around. It's not overbearing with the proof. But the flavor at the end on the finish is outstanding. It tastes like a s'more.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Like it's totally like, we think it's really unique, but the color, the mouthfeel, the viscosity, and like in a blind taste, people will think it's a high rye bourbon. You know, it's not uncommon, but you just don't see many double oak ryes. And then the toasted barrel for another 18 months just gives it some really interesting notes that I find to be fun. And I agree, like that I'm still kind of salivating and almost to the point where it's drying up the sides of my mouth.
Yeah. I mean, I'm with you. I love the Woodford Double Oak. I think it's outstanding. I will drink that any day. And there's a lot of double oaks that I really like. But the rye, I have never had a rye double oak or a toasted barrel or, you know, whatever we want to call it, in terms of, you know, other bourbons. But I don't know if it's the rye, like the spice from the rye that adds to it, but like that finish is so good.
Cheers to that. Thank
you. And the 96 proofs, and I mean, I don't know what like the other bourbons are at the double oak or toasted barrels, but that 96 proof is really nice. Because I feel like if it was down like in the lower 80s, it might get kind of sweet. I don't know. I think you kind of lose it.
It is. And, you know, it's interesting, too. This is the fun thing about the lab is, like, trying everything at every point and a half down. Like, you start, and you just come down a point and a half, point and a half, and you just start narrowing in a range. And it's like, okay, this one seems to be really great from 98 to 103. Let's start playing a little bit in that range or whatever it may be. And people say, when's the cast strength version of Double O coming out? And I was like, the ops team has told me that it actually thinks it kind of takes away from the experience. And I said, come on, let me try it. Let me hear it and make sure I can speak to it. And they handed me a version of it once. It was about 117 proof, actually. And man, it just was just heat galore. Mm-hmm. And I felt like it all of a sudden took away from what I associate Double Oak. And like you said, this wide range of just tasting notes that you get and this beautiful finish. Like it's flavorful, it's bold, but it's like palatable. And it's like got a lot going on. It's just the orange zest,
mm-hmm.
different things, a little bit of honey. It just, I don't know. It's cool.
Yeah, I mean, I think you don't want to dull that so much just for the sake of the high proof. I mean, and I know people love high proofs, and I like high proofs too, but
totally.
You come out with a high proof Double Oak rye, like it's not going to sit on the shelf. But for a enjoyment perspective, I do think this is probably in a better, you know, range in terms of the proof than, you know, getting something 115 plus.
Yeah, there's products where that makes perfect sense. And
sure.
When it does, that's the way we bottle them.
I don't want to take up your entire day, but walk through just a couple of your other bottles that you guys are offering. Because I know you got some finishes. You know, give me a couple, an idea of some of the other ones that you guys have out there right now.
Absolutely. So let's think about what. So we have a reserve series, and it's a release in the spring. It's a release in the fall. It's always something different. Kind of shows innovation and the versatility of rye whiskey. And the size of the releases can vary, any, you know, 400 cases, 800 cases, whatever it may be. But they're kind of, when they're gone, they're gone. The one that might be out there, if you're lucky, remaining from the fall is one called the Manhattan Finish. And what we did is we took took 4-year, 9-month-old whiskey, and we sourced bitter barrels, vermouth barrels, and cherry brandy barrels. Put our whiskey in there for another a year and 9 months. And finished in those, deconstructed the tasting notes that you would get from like the most classic cocktail of all time, the Manhattan, and then basically created a blend of those. It's not a cocktail. It's not like a finished like Manhattan cocktail. This is we bottled it at 103 proof, so it was like very much a rye whiskey with these beautiful complements of like bright cherry, hibiscus, like it just like. Baking spices, like that one's really fun. That one was beautiful, Double Gold in San Francisco. If you can find it, grab it. It was really cool. I thought it was a really bold call by the ops team to go for that, but they went for it and it turned out absolutely amazing. I'm super proud of the team for that. The one that's out there right now that's always interesting, people are kind of like, whoa, I don't know what to think, is the one that we finished our rye whiskey in extra añejo tequila barrels. And when they say, whoa, I don't know what to think, when they look at the label, they're like, is that a bad night in college? Whiskey? Kind of thing, you know? It's just like...
Some plastic bottles and...
Totally, right? And it's just one of those things, it's like no, like really great tequila and really great whiskey follow a very similar process. You know, extra añejo is actually, you know, it's kind of like, is a fairly new concept in the tequila world. And so we took 5-year-old rye whiskey and finished in some extra añejo tequila barrels that had tequila in them for, I think it was over 4 years. Mm-hmm. And then we rested in those for another 9 months, proofed it at 98 proof. I think it's one of the most beautiful whiskeys out there. It got a gold medal in San Francisco. It has this really beautiful honey, agave, vanilla notes with this like little bit of pepper spice in there. And it is so easy to drink. There was, I think it was the Whiskey Wash that just recently wrote an article about it and talked about how really unique and different it was. And they kind of got to the end. They're like, I know I shouldn't be using this word, but I'm going to use this word to describe this whiskey. It's refreshing. It's just like, you never hear that about whiskey.
No. So
that's like my summer whiskey right now. So like, I'll drink it neat. I'll drink it on the rocks. I'll drink it in a highball with ice and soda water and lime on a really hot night. It's fun. It's unique. It's different. We've done one finished in Calvados barrels, cognac barrels. It had a cognac in for 30 years. We did a port wine that won World's Best Rye Whiskey in San Francisco in 2019. So it's a fun little line. Keep an eye on it. We've got some fun stuff coming out in the fall. We got some fun stuff spring 2022 and beyond. You can always sign up to be a whiskey thief on our website. So you'll be the first to know about any special release before anybody else. But it's just a way to kind of have a little bit of fun and again, show the versatility of rye whiskey. So you got the core products, the signature rye, you know, the kind of just the original rye that we released. It's about 70% of our sales. Our double oak, which we sampled, cash drink, which speaks for itself. And then, you know, we have this reserve line. And then if you ever bump into a retailer or somebody, we do barrel picks. And so they'll pick a barrel. And that's all 6-year-old, 110 proof rye whiskey. Typically retails about $60. So we try to drive really premium whiskeys, ultra premium whiskeys, but for a small supplier, hopefully you find them fairly priced.
Yeah, there's a number of other ones I'm definitely going to be going back to get because these are, we're 2 for 2 in terms of liking the ones I've grabbed, the one you sent me and then the one I went and picked up this morning. So there's a lot of other ones I'm definitely going to have to try out.
Awesome.
What is your distribution? Are you guys, widespread is distribution? And then are you guys direct to consumers from you guys or a third party?
So there's a few options out there. Good question. So we're in 41 states. Some states we have a little bit better presence than the other. Kind of, you know, Boston down through Florida, we have a pretty solid presence. You know, the Chicagos, the Texas, the Colorados, Arizona, California, Washington State, that sort of thing. And working into other some markets as well, Indiana, Tennessee, Missouri, and so forth. And then there are definitely a lot of, especially COVID, you know, brought so many online retailers, which was cool for us, which really helped a small guy out. And so there's classic, you know, third-party websites that could deliver to almost all states, whether it's a Reserve Bar or Caskers or something along those lines. Drizzly, if you're on ground, or GoPuff, something like that. So we use all those. And then we're in a couple of countries as well. We're in China, we're in Japan, we're in the UK, Canada, and soon to be a few more in New Zealand. We're in New Zealand as well. So just a few markets where we have a great relationship and the people have a great appreciation for whiskey. So we're so slowly getting out there. We just turned 5 years old. Got a lot of work to still do, but it's been fun.
I bet, man. I mean, that's got to be, it's always nice when you have a job you can go to work and enjoy. And like, I mean, 5 years being in 41 states is huge. I mean, that's not an easy thing to do.
It's not. I mean, open up states, man. I mean, every state, it's not like, we're the same as Maryland. And
no.
The same as Tennessee. And no. Everyone's like, welcome to our laws and our reporting and our way we do it. And our licensing is just like, okay, got it. Church and state, got it. You know? It works though, and it creates revenue in their state, so they want to get it there. But again, you just got to do it in a compliant way, and we're in business long term, so we get it done.
For sure. Social media, where's the best place for people to find you guys?
At Sagamore Spirit on Instagram. We do a little bit of Twitter. Facebook's a great one, obviously. I don't know. We probably need to get our act together someday and look at that TikTok thing, but Instagram seems to be the big one, and Facebook's the big one. And then, like I said, you go to our website, sagamorespirit.com, sign up to become a whiskey thief. We won't pester you. We only send out emails when we think there's something valuable to share.
Awesome. Brian, I really appreciate your time. Appreciate the bottle you guys sent out. This was great. Really appreciate it.
Tony, this is huge for a small little brand like ours to come on your show. So thank you very much for the opportunity. Cheers.
Of course. I'll make sure to get this out there.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right, man. Take care.